This Emmy win is especially meaningful to me because my award-winning piece is a piece I produce on the beauty and culture of Africa, the continent that raised me. Growing up in Ethiopia, I watched my mother produce meaningful content to uplift the voices of others, and I thought that was powerful and I wanted to do the same. So thank you, Mom. I wouldn't have been here without your inspiration. I also want to thank my County Cable Montgomery team as well as my council family for all their love and support throughout the years. And last but not least, my husband Eric for always being supportive and understanding when I need to work late to meet deadlines. I love you all. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Dr. Sandra Jowers-Barber, Director of the Division of Humanities and Criminology at the University of the District of Columbia Community College and host of UDC Forum. Welcome. On this edition of UDC Forum, we have a UDC graduate, Mashar Salu, who is with us this evening to talk about her accomplishments. She is an award-winning journalist, and we are just so happy to have her with us. And I must take a moment to say that she was one of my students, and I am the proud professor. Welcome.
Thank you so much, Professor Jowers. I'm so happy to join you today.
Tell us about your journey to UDC, at UDC, and from UDC to American and to your award-winning status as a journalist.
Yes, of course. So I came to UDC as an international student right after high school. I think when I was 17, I'm originally from Ethiopia, so that's where I completed my secondary education. And then I came to the US to pursue my higher education. I ended up applying to UDC and, you know, I got in and I've always wanted to study journalism because my mother was a journalist growing up. She was on TV. She was a TV reporter. Then she was a press secretary for one of the presidents of Ethiopia. And then she worked in PR, where she did documentaries for the United Nations, the International Labor Organization. And whenever I didn't have school, she would take me with her. So I got exposed to that like very early on. And so I knew when I was like maybe 11 or 12 years old that I was going to go to college and study journalism. But I also really loved to write. So at the time, I ended up taking the mass media major and, you know, focus on print journalism so I can enhance my writing skills. And then, you know, through UDC, I took different classes. But I've also really tried to do different internships around the DC area. And that's the best thing about going to any university in the DC area. You can just hop on the metro and go to any place to, you know, to pursue internships and opportunities. So I got an internship at the Voice of America in the TV department, the Africa, English to Africa department. And that exposed me to video editing, writing for TV. So I thought, okay, I love writing. Now I'm really liking this whole video editing stuff. So why don't I do both? So I ended up taking a second concentration at UDC, which was like the television production at the time. I know the program has changed quite a bit since I left. But I started taking a lot of classes with Professor Lloyd Jones, who is awesome and really taught me, like, you know, writing for TV, for film. We took like lighting classes, audio classes, and Professor Hanif like taught us editing. So all those classes and experiences combined led to me, like, you know, like working at PBS, at PBS Kiss Digital when I graduated. I actually got the job before I even graduated, which was awesome. And, you know, I did a little bit of like web writing, which I had experience in because thanks to Professor Vassell's class of web journalism. And I also did like some video, but I really wanted to go back to journalism. So that's why I ended up going to American University to pursue my master's in broadcast journalism and public affairs. And I'm working in journalism now at Montgomery County government.
That is an interesting story. I love the fact that you knew exactly what you wanted to do and you had the opportunity through your mother to be exposed to it. And that's just what you needed for that foundation. And you took advantage of everything to offer. We say at the university that the district is a classroom. And the opportunity to have those experiential experiences and to get the internships is really critical. How has journalism changed without being very political? We know in the last 5 years, the term fake news has become very common. What are your feelings now about your field?
Well, I think, you know, with the growth of social media, you know, journalism has changed. Like now, I think when social media became like big, you know, not when it first started, but when it became like a thing, everybody was just obsessed with getting like clicks, you know, to their stories. And, you know, how many clicks are you getting? How many people have interacted with your story? So that became like the focus of why they produce their stories, as opposed to on producing the story because it has some meaning. So I feel like that has changed because of that. That's one thing that has changed. And like, you know, TV stations, again, because of social media, just really putting an emphasis on ratings. You know, if let's say a show was great, but people are not like watching or are not as interested in it, you know, it just gets cut. And a lot of people, I think their attention span change as well. You see, before, I feel like people took the time to, like, let's say, watch a 5-minute video. Now, like, even through work, I see this because I also manage social media for the county government. And when we post, like, a 2-minute story, that has more views till the end than a 5-minute video that's, like, more detailed, includes, you know, several different elements. But a quick Twitter video will get more views because that's just the attention span people have. So I think it's changed like quite a bit in those different areas.
How have you been able to adapt? And is there any ethical change that you've seen?
Yeah, so in terms of adapting, like as somebody that like manages the social media accounts, I always try to stay up to date with trends. Because I also do run the analytics every quarter. And so when I see our number dip in a certain place, I have to like check, look into that and see why. Sometimes like, you know, social media like platforms change their algorithm whenever they want, whether it's Facebook or Instagram. And so sometimes you wonder like, wait, I was getting like, let's say, I don't know, like 100 views. Now I'm getting like 5. Like what's going on? It's because it has changed. So I think just staying up, like reading and like staying up on the trends, just keeping up with that is always important so we can adapt accordingly. And as for like the ethical question, I mean, like for me, for instance, like whenever I post stories, like even to this day, I never post a story thinking, okay, it's going to get clicks. Like I know some people, they would have a headline that would catch people's attention, but when you click, it's like something completely different. So I don't think, to me, that's like totally wrong. You know, you're just getting people to like just give you that click, but you're not really caring about journalism, about the storytelling, about the content creation. So I try to avoid doing that. We absolutely don't do that with county government for sure.
One of the things that's happened since the murder of George Floyd and social media is the combination of seeing social injustice and the opportunity for many young people across ethnic lines, socioeconomic status, coming together to challenge that. And have you seen more of an interest for younger people, for even social media platforms and the print journalism, the desire to be able to be journalists and document and record for a wider audience?
Yes. So I think it's important to understand that, you know, see, back in the day, you might say, okay, I'm going to pick print journalism and you're going to stick to, you know, the newspaper, the magazine, and not care about all the other digital platforms. But these days, it's all related. Whether you're in print, like it has to be published on a website, that has to go on the, you know, social media, because that's kind of how our content gets moved around. That's where people tune in the most. So I think it's really important to understand that. And as for, you know, like people like using that platform to tell a story or to like quickly report something that is wrong, you know, or unjust, I think that it's become a great platform. And I think younger people are definitely using it. There's people that are using it in the wrong way, but there's a lot of people that are also using it the right way. Like, for instance, like even now there's a war going on in the Middle East, and we see updates that you don't necessarily see on the news, right? When you turn on the news, you might not see those exact footages that people are posting that are on the grounds there, putting it on their social media. So I think it's also become a good way to stay informed. But it's important when we're consuming that content that we ask ourselves, okay, is this a reliable source? You know, can it be manipulated? I mean, with AI and everything, you never know what you're watching. So I think it's really important to ask yourself, like, what that source is. And if it's a source that's never been heard before, or they have a history of, like, you know, pushing out fake news, I wouldn't trust it. But there's, you know, individuals that are on the grounds, just regular people that are not necessarily journalists, that are saying, this is what's going on, this is what we're seeing. And so I think it's become a great tool for that matter.
How do you decide what it is you're going to write? I mean, are you in a position now that you are reporting, you're in a few, can you pick your stories? And then, of course, tell us about the award-winning projects that you've done.
Yeah. So I am incredibly grateful. I have a very supportive boss, a supportive team. And so I really, you know, sometimes I don't necessarily even pitch my stories. I just, you know, like, book my camera person and like go for the story and do it. And so I do pick my stories. Yes. I do a lot of research. I do speak to a lot of people in the community. You know, I just tell them, hey, like, for instance, I have like a business show that I produce every month called Made in Montgomery. And, you know, I might tell people, you know, if you ever hear of an interesting local business, just let me know. Or if I'm out and about in the community and I go to an interesting business, I might, you know, ask them for their business, or I'll give my business card and, you know, I'll try to do a story on them. And that's kind of how I get my story ideas. For the human interest story, it's the same way. Sometimes I get my information from like Google, you know, if somebody did a story on somebody, I might choose a different angle to feature them as a Montgomery County resident or somebody that's like, you know, has some kind of tie to Montgomery County government, because we work for the government. And so I'm in a position to do that. And I always try to find something that would show the community and really bring the community together. So that's always been my focus. Now, when it comes to the award-winning film, I also, again, with that, was my idea. I came up with the concept, the theme for that year. So how the whole thing started is, just to give you a little background, Montgomery County Council like celebrates African Heritage Month every September. And it was the first jurisdiction to declare September as African Heritage Month in the country. So when I actually came across that information, I went to my boss and I said, this is before African Heritage Month existed. And I said to her, Montgomery County is the first jurisdiction to declare September as African Heritage Month. I think, you know, we should celebrate it like we celebrate Hispanic Heritage Month and Asian American Pacific Islander Month. And she was very supportive. You know, I took it all the way up to the council president's office and it got approved and it became one of the commemorations. So I came up with this theme because I really wanted to showcase like the African culture and tradition. And I thought the best way to see that was through the food, through the clothes, through the music, the dance, and what was the fifth category? It's escaping me now. But I felt like those are like the best ways to really see Africa and, you know, the people behind this. So that's kind of how the idea came about. I pitched it. Everybody loved it. So then I went ahead and tried to find different people to speak on these different topics, these different categories. And I was actually getting ready to go on maternity leave. So I had to schedule all my interviews prior to leaving. And then I was out for 3.5 months. So when I got back, I only had 4 weeks to put the whole thing together, to do all the interviews, write my script, edit, and all that stuff. So it was I had fun doing it, even though it was like very hectic. But I also like was really happy with the final product because, you know, I was able to show Africa's richness, you know, African culture and all that, because a lot of times, you know, or actually some people might think that, you know, Africa's all about famine and war. And, you know, it's really important to shine a light on the good stuff, you know, like there's a lot of good things also happening there. So, yeah, so that's kind of how it came about.
I never dreamed this career was possible. I absolutely love what I do.
The professors were there to make me successful.
I got 2 promotions and graduated debt-free.
I didn't know it was possible to secure a fellowship at an Ivy League school, but UDC helped me achieve that.
I wouldn't even be where I am if it wouldn't have been for UDC. The university and its professor opened me up to something that just had changed my life tremendously.
UDC helped me find my possible.
Find your possible. Visit udc.edu/possible to learn more.
So you're combining motherhood with your career, and you are doing so well at it. Are you teaching, are you giving back to the community in that sense and giving them that joy that you obviously have from being able to be a journalist?
Yes. So I go to, you know, like youth, like summits, and like, for instance, like in a week or November, whatever November 30th is, I'm going to the University of Maryland to speak to students. The Ethiopian and Eritrean Student Association is organizing an event. So I'm going to that to speak with people, you know, to encourage people on, I mean, students on their career, you know, what steps they should take after college, helping them apply to internships. And I've been so lucky that in my current job, I manage the internship program. And so, you know, we receive applications, I interview our interns, they join us. We usually get about like 2 interns a semester. And so, you know, it really gives me a lot of pleasure to like take them on shoots with me. And it's a lot of times it's journalism students, because obviously, you know, it would be a good way to learn, you know, about the field. And, you know, I take them on shoots with me. I let them, you know, write their own questions, even do interviews. And I let them shoot because I really want them to do, you know, like have the hands-on experience instead of just looking and learning, because that's what helped me when I was an intern. So I give back in that sense. I try to be a mentor as much as I can. And in the future, I definitely would, you know, love to teach like either high school level or university level, like definitely focusing on journalism and production.
With everything that's going on in terms of the political aspect of journalism, how are you able to maneuver when you're doing a report that is touching on some political hot button issues? I know that the documentary was just amazing and what it did and for the African heritage. What about those issues that of homelessness and of poverty? How are you treating those? And what do you see with the young people that you are mentoring? Are they somewhat jaded, or are they enthusiastic? Are they ready to change the world?
Yeah, I'll start answering the last part of your question. So I've had like different kind of interns. So I would have to say a little bit of both. Now, I've had interns that kind of remind me of me when I was their age, just eager to learn, eager to get their hands on, like, you know, like real stuff, like, you know, cutting a story or writing something for like TV. So those kind of students are definitely easier to, you know, mentor. It's like you just give them projects and it's like the next day it's done. I've had to like adjust the way I, you know, like manage them and work with them when I see those that are kind of like a little bit laid back and they just, you know, they're there to say they've interned really, but they don't really, you know, they would do like small things, but they don't really care. So I try to, you know, get them out, you know, have them shoot something. Oh, like do this, do that. And just to get them a little bit more excited. So, and I think for some it has worked, for some, for others, it's just like, it just stays the same. Maybe they're in the wrong field. And, you know, I think it's important to try different internships to see what you're interested in. So maybe that field wasn't for them. Because when I was in school, I interned at the radio station at NPR, I interned in print media. But it took, for me, I interned at a law firm, which I knew then, like, corporate communication wasn't going to be for me. So I think it's important for you to, like, go to different places and realize, okay, this is not going to make me happy. So let me try something different. So that's just how I see it. And the other part, now I forgot the other part of the question was.
I was asking about those issues that aren't as fun, the poverty and homelessness that is across every state in our country.
Absolutely. So, you know, there's, of course, issues like domestic violence that I've worked on in the past, which was, you know, some stories were hard to listen to. I spoke to domestic violence survivors that, you know, like tell that they were free, like they were comfortable enough to share their story with me. But, you know, those were not easy stories to hear. And also, you know, when you hear the data about, you know, how many people are abused. And so I've worked on those kind of stories. But I always, whenever I do, I work on stories like that, I always try to focus on kind of like what's being done and how do you prevent it? What are red flags? I try to focus the story on that so it could help somebody else from, you know, being a victim of that. I'm currently working on a human trafficking documentary, which is going to be a 15-minute piece, which I've been working on for 2 years now before I gave birth to my son. Like, it's just, it's been so tough because it's just such a sensitive topic. It's been incredibly tough to get a hold of people to interview. So I'm still working on that. I've worked on a homelessness piece before where I was on the, actually I worked on this documentary when I was at AU, an American for a class for a documentary, where I went around Silver Spring, Maryland and DC and talked to homeless people that, you know, didn't want to go to homeless shelters because they feared for their lives. So they're out on the street, not getting any help, you know? So it was just like, it was definitely a heartbreaking story. So I do work with that, those kind of stories. But I always try to end my story with like, okay, there's hope. Maybe, you know, we'll get fixed. This is what's being done now, and this is what needs to be done in the future for it to go away. So, yeah.
As we see, there are more and more reporters on television that look like us, more and more women, more people of color. And it's just, it's very important, of course, to be able to see yourself, especially for our young people who want to go into the profession. But what are your aspirations? Are you looking for a CBS, Nora O'Donnell role, April Ryan? Is the press house secretary in your future? What are your aspirations?
So for me, I decided, like, a few years ago that I didn't want to go into news. That wasn't going to be for me. I wanted to work more on like long form documentaries. Now where I'm now, I do produce a news segment, but it's not like a daily news. It's like once a week thing, you know, kind of like this is what's happening in the county type of thing. I didn't necessarily like, for me, at least personally, the culture in the newsroom. I did that at VOA. I didn't like it as much. And then I had interviewed for a job where I was told that, when I pronounce certain words, I have an accent. So it was kind of like, okay, maybe this is that, you know, the right, route for me. So I don't necessarily want to do that, but what I really want to work on is, working on documentaries that really, tell stories that haven't been told. And I really want to be able to travel and you know, be on the grounds, let's say, like in Africa and, you know, tell as a proud African. I keep talking about Africa, but I really want to focus on Africa because there's so much that hasn't been told. You know, there's a lot there. So so I want to be able to do that. And so I need to find a job that would allow me to do that. Maybe working for the World Bank or like the United Nations. My mom worked for the ILO. That's what allowed her to travel all of East Africa, and then they even expanded her role to like Southern Africa, where she focused on women entrepreneurs in those regions that were really poor, but they, you know, took whatever they had to start their own business. It was part of the ILO's WEDGE project, women entrepreneurship development and gender equality. So that's a topic that interests me. I've always been into, you know, women empowerment. So maybe doing something similar to what my mom did would be where I see myself in the future.
I can't wait to see what you do when you go to Africa, Ethiopia, whatever part you're in, to do the documentary. And you're right, it's so needed. Far too many times people say Africa and they make it sound like it's a country versus a continent. So that would just simply be amazing. Has your son shown any interest in journalism?
Well, one is four, the other one is one. So I think they're probably, they don't know that. They've shown a lot of interest in sports so far. So we'll see, you know.
Excellent. Well, it has been a pleasure having you with us. I look forward to having you come back and interviewing you again. So thank you very much.
Thank you so much for having me.
And for those of you who want to know more about the degree programs offered by the University of the District of Columbia, please visit the website at www.udc.edu. And to know more about the certificates and associate degrees offered by the community college, visit that website, www.udc.edu/cc. Thank you for joining us, and we'll see you next time on UDC Forum.